Hello, everyone, and welcome to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art, California State University, Dominguez Hills. And we are well into our course, halfway through, and we're just completing our midterm, which, by the way, will be closing today. And I understand there were a few problems, primarily the problem of folks using Internet Explorer 8 and having problems with the submit button. That kind of got hidden, didn't it? Some people had a hard time finding that. And that's because that rascal, Internet Explorer 8, has a little problem with letting that show. So, in the future, make sure you use Firefox browser or Internet Explorer 7, and that way you won't have that problem. Don't use Internet Explorer 8. Now, as a result of that, I'm going to leave the midterm open a little longer than 5 o'clock. I'll probably close it maybe around 10 o'clock. So some of you who had those Halloween festivities prevent you from completing the midterm, and also some of you who had problems with the submit button, you'll have a few extra hours to get that midterm taken care of. So I'll do you the honor and courtesy of leaving that open just a little bit longer. Okay, I also wanted to mention that the ArtSite visit paper is coming up real soon. I know that we're only halfway through the semester, but you know what? When we hit November, it's like the door is closing on the semester real fast. And November goes by really fast. So it behooves you to get started on that ArtSite visit paper and get yourself going. I sent out an email and an announcement on that. And my intent was to have you kind of get yourself in gear and start moving toward having that taken care of. So if you have any questions or concerns, let me know. To remind you again, I did prepare a video, which is up on YouTube, that tells you how to go through the entire process of completing the ArtSite visit paper. And the website for that is up on Blackboard, and you can find that. I think I posted that for you once before, in fact, on an announcement. So it might be to your advantage to go and look at that video, because it does a very thorough job of telling you how to answer almost all the questions. I think I covered all the questions on there. And went through an example, I prepared the paper, showed you how I found the artwork. Let's do the whole thing. So go through that before you start the paper so you have an idea of what it is that I'm asking you to do in that ArtSite visit paper. Again, if you have questions, let me know. And the best way to get in touch with me is to email me. I had a few students call me about the midterm, and they were just pulling their hair saying, get back to me, please get back to me. And I don't come on campus but a couple times a week, so I don't always get my phone messages until I'm back on campus. So you're, you know, pulling your hair out during the weekend and I can't help you. So email me. I look at my email a number of times every day and try to stay on top of the questions that you might have. So please let me know. Let me remind you also that the ArtSite visit paper is due on Tuesday, November 30th. Now, that is, kind of after Thanksgiving. And it has to be delivered or postmarked by November 30th. So make sure you take care of that. Also, I might add, late papers will be reduced in grade. So you need to get that paper in on time. All right. Now, today we're going to be talking about two chapters, Arts and Crafts, which is Chapter 12, and Architecture. And we have a guest who's going to be coming in for Architecture, so that should be exciting. So we're at break, we'll bring in our guests, get him all seated, and we'll continue with Architecture. And let's talk about crafts. The chapter on crafts covers five areas of crafts. There's many more, but these are the primary ones that the author wanted to put in our text. So we have clay, glass, metal, wood, and fiber. These are the five areas that our author is covering. And I have a question for you. And the question is, who is Maria Martinez? Who is Maria Martinez? Now, this is the person that's covered in our text. And I want to see if you've been reading the text. So you can phone 1-800-339-1193, or you can text and let me know who Maria Martinez might be. Now, she's not that pretty girl who sits up in the front row. No, that's not the Maria Martinez I'm talking about. This is someone else, okay? Let's see if you can tell me who this is. Okay, let's talk about clay. There are four methods of working with clay. Pitch pot, which is pitching and just with your thumbs and fingers, and slab construction, which is rolling out the clay flat, cutting out shapes, and then putting those together. Clay, we've all done that when we were kids. We would roll out the clay with our hands and then coil it around to make a construction of pot or some sort. And the last is the potter's wheel, or throwing clay using the potter's wheel. Now, I want to show you a video that demonstrates a number of these, done by a colleague of mine here at the university, Jim Cavell. He's a great ceramist, great teacher, really a great guy. And if you happen to come to university and you take his course, you'll find it to be a great joy to learn about clay. So he demonstrates for us a number of these techniques. So let's take a look at this, and you'll see firsthand how these techniques are done. Okay.
Now I'm at a potter's wheel, and once again, I've prepared this clay by wedging it and then forming it into a simple cone shape with the bottom rounded off. And first, I'm going to slap it down on the head of the wheel. We call this the wheel head. And before I can start bringing form to this lump of clay, I have to do what's called centering. Water is essential to lubricate the lump of clay so that it moves smoothly in your hands. So I'm going to start spinning it. And then centering, the wheel head will be spinning the fastest. So the first thing I need to do is what's called coning up. Brings the clay up. And I'm going to compress it back down. And essentially, I'm going to do that two or three times. And what's absolutely important is that you're comfortable at the wheel. Because everybody has techniques for coning. And knowing maybe different techniques you may see at another time. But everyone must be comfortable. So I'm going to cone up. Now I've set it for the clay. I'm ready to start opening it up and bringing the balls up. What I'm going to throw for you is just a simple cylinder. Most of the way forms on the wheel begin as a cylinder and then we measure into different shapes. Now I'll slow the wheel down and then the first part is opening the center. So I'm going to push my thumb. Reaching for my bucket of water to help keep the spinning form lubricated. Now I'm going to press the block. I'm and we also use this small mango cushion that are about so that it needs a nice tight fit. Now I'm ready to start making the balls of the sphere. What I'm doing is I'm pulling my fingers together like this around the pot and squeezing the plant upwards until it starts to take form. And now you can see that this big window is getting much slower. Other times I will take the thin sponge and I'll leave the water trail down my fingers to help lubricate the sweating pot.
Okay, there we have a good example of the fundamentals of throwing by Jim Cabell. And I also wanted to show you, before I do that, I've got a collaboration going on here, a collaboration of response about Maria Martinez. Maria Martinez. I've got, how many students have I got who's in on this? I got 5 students in on this collaboration statement. I've got Maria, Lilith, Selena, Philip, and Wendy. And they're all saying, if I'm interpreting this right, Maria Martinez is a well-known Pueblo potter. She is famous for the use of brown-black patterns on her pots, where the pattern is formed by matte and burnished areas. She died in 1980 and also had one of her pots in the White House with FDR. You know who FDR was? Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Right. Well, all of you out there, you 5 collaborators, you're absolutely right. Absolutely right. Maria Martinez was an interesting person. Let me just show you something. I just had to look her up on the internet. I didn't bring my text in. And I just wanted to show you some of her ceramics here. Let me just get this up big so you can see it, if I can get it up here. Here it is. You can see it's black on black. It's called black on black, and it's really a technique that was developed. It's really derived from primitive Pueblo pottery, and it's actually a coil process and then smoothed out. So this is not turned, as we just saw demonstrated by Jim Cavell, but rather done totally by hand. And it's a fabulous process, and it demonstrates the kind of work that she did. Here's a picture of Maria Martinez in her senior years, kind of like where I am right now. And she's a very happy woman. She's a very, very nice woman from what I understand the readings. And she lived in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and all her life. And she was asked to develop this technique and came up with this marvelous, unique black-on-black pottery, which became internationally known and renowned. And her husband, also Julian, contributed to the work, so it was a collaboration. So the 5 of you out there, thank you for that comment. Very good comment. Okay, let's move right along. Let me just show you some. This is a piece, by the way, that was turned. I happened to pick these up from Jim Cavell just before class, and he gave me this piece. It demonstrates also one of the kind of clays that's used. There's 3 basic kind of clays that are used. One is a terracotta, or sometimes called earthenware. This is a stoneware. You can tell stoneware, it's a kind of a light brown on the back, and where it's raw, this has got glaze on it, so it doesn't show it on the glaze part. But right here, I can feel the rawness. So you can look at the bottom of a piece where there's raw clay that's been fired, and if you see that light brown, that's that's probably a stoneware. This piece is a slab construction that he gave me. This is gone through the first firing called the bisque firing. And it will now be glazed if they want to glaze it and then put into the final firing. And this, you can see, is made up of rectangular shapes, very thin. These are the slabs, and they're put together with a lid here and made into a nice little container for all your jewelry and gold and pearls and things of that sort. So this technique, you want to know those four techniques: pinching, slab construction, coiling, and potter's wheels. Those might show up a little later on in your quizzes or somewhere else, so make sure you know those. Okay, let's talk about glass. I don't really know much about glass other than what I've seen. I haven't actually dealt with glass work by any means, except when I was in high school and we had to bend glass in chemistry class. I remember that. Okay, this is a Portland piece. This is a beautiful piece. It came from the first century of common era. It's a Roman piece, actually, if I remember correctly. And it's uniquely done. It has the dark blue background, and then the foreground, kind of a cameo-like technique, is done separately, and it's still a mystery how it is adhered to the piece. So these beautiful figures, these Roman classic figures, are done as a unique kind of glassware and attached to the glass, and it's still a mystery how that's done. Isn't it interesting how people from antiquity can have these mysteries that we can't solve? Another piece, stained glass, is a marvelous kind of technique that we see it all around us in private homes, in religious buildings. We see it in public buildings, and we even see it as decoration many times, that are pieces that are hung, that kind of wear. And it's a type of technique that is derived from medieval times, and techniques of making glass different colors, and then holding them in frames of lead moldings to make these incredible designs. Also, there are techniques of drawing on the glass with paint and letting that be a supplement to color. It's an interesting technique. We have here in the Los Angeles area one of the famous glass studios up in Mount Washington, I think it is, up near Pasadena, called Judson Studios. And I had the opportunity to visit them one time and saw their glasswork. They do glasswork, windows, and all those types of things for clients throughout the world. And they've done a lot of famous pieces. So you might hear their name once in a while if you ever deal with glass. All right, let's talk about metal. There's four types of techniques with metal that our author talks about. One is forging, which is like blacksmithing. You've seen the Western movies where the blacksmith is sitting there pounding away on this red-hot iron on top of an anvil. Well, that's called forging. And it's heating metal until it's red hot and hammering it into a shape. So it's a fundamental technique, very, very old. Another technique is embossing. This is when we hammer a piece of metal while it's hot. We hammer it from the back. So we'll get metal hot and then hammer it from the back to make a shape. They usually hammer it over shaped iron or steel forms, like round forms or angled forms, depending on what they want to form, what kind of shape they want. Another technique is called chasing. I'm going to show you some examples of some of these in just a little bit. And our book, by the way, shows some great examples of these. Chasing, fine detail done with from the front when metal is cooled. This is very much like we talked about when we were talking about printmaking and intaglio, when we would gouge the metal with tools to make scratches in it. Well, this is a similar kind of process, except they use what's called chasing tools, and they'll incise into the metal. And the last one is a damascening, which is an inlay with precious metals or other precious materials that are used to combine metals. And we have a good example here of this virginette of Charles V, and it's a helmet-like configuration. And you can see these beautiful shapes that are incised, that are put in with the damascened technique. And also this has embossing done. You can see how the metal is raised here. That's an embossing technique. And these techniques are combined, obviously. They can be combined to make these wonderful, wonderful forms. Now, from metal is also included jewelry, like silversmithing and gold, working in gold and other precious metals. I have a couple of examples here to show you. This is one by Susan Fortune called Leather and Silver Neck Piece. It's a beautiful piece that combines leather and silver. You can see the leather in this area and the silver. And even within the silver, I think there might be a stone in here. I'm not really sure if these are stones or it looks like they are. It didn't say in the information on that piece, but I have a hunch that those are stones. One more piece is a series of jewelry pieces. This is just a composite of pieces just to show the variety. You can see this very modern piece done with kind of unique metals and a lot of linear pieces, kind of a figure-like image. Earrings here. I'm not sure what those are made of. This is a lot of modern artists will do some very interesting pieces that might be simple for looking at. They're not necessarily made to be worn at all, which we normally think of as jewelry. So this is an area that you want to be aware of, particularly those four methods of forming metal. Make sure you look at those up close. Wood. Let's talk about wood just for a second here. Wood is the most readily available. It's one of the most easiest to work materials, but it's not very durable. I mean, we know that wood will rot. It can be attacked by termites and perhaps other creatures. And so it just doesn't have very much longevity to it. But beautiful pieces can be done. Let's look at this piece from Indonesia woodwork. This is a piece that I happened to find I thought was very fascinating because it showed the intricate work that can be done. Look at this carving on this piece. This is a doorway. Look how it fits up here in the top, how they fitted this framework to the opening of the piece. And the intricate designs, the very, very delicate work that's done on this piece. It's incredible. One more piece, a wooden lion head. I thought you'd like this because it shows a number of different wood types of wood used in this composition of a lion head. It looks kind of like a cartoon lion head, but nevertheless, it's using wood in a very interesting way to show the combination that can be done. And these are rather modest compared to what can be done with wood. And I'm sure if you, like, I remember one time going to the L.A. County Fair and seeing some woodwork at the L.A. County Fair. It's a number of years ago, and my kids were younger. We dragged them to the fair, and the woodwork was incredible. It's incredible what some folks can do. So it's a marvelous, marvelous kind of media to use. Now, last is fiber. My mother loved to do quilts, and she loved to do, she got into knitting in her older age, did a lot of crocheting, and I'm sure some of your family members might have worked in fabrics as well in many ways. Not necessarily all women, by the way. There's men who work in fabrics. Some of the best tailors are men. And so fiber is a fascinating material to use for crafts. And there are several techniques that our author tells us about. One is weaving. This is the use of a loom. That's a frame of interwoven parallel fibers and then another set of fibers that are arranged perpendicular to it. And the warp are the fibers that are held taut. The warp. You need to know this. The warp are the taut fibers. And then the weft, sometimes called the woof, kind of like our dog, woof, woof, those are the fibers that are interwoven that we put in between the taut fibers. So you need to know those two sets. Those might come up and bite you right in the back, so be careful about that. Make sure you know those. Let's look at one piece that is a woven piece. This is a Inca tunic from Peru, done in 1500. This technique of weaving has been around for centuries and centuries. It's a way that mankind has made fabrics forever. But look at the beautiful, beautiful textures on this. This looks like one of the fabrics, like each one of these squares was done individually. But it's all done by weaving. There are the rope strings coming down here, and then woven in between are the woof threads, and by alternating those and dyeing them different color, they end up with this beautiful, beautiful tunic. So it shows the incredible technique that can be done. And last in this area, then we're going to take a break, is tapestry. And tapestry are yarns that are manipulated freely to form patterns or designs. It's a variation of weaving, but done with incredible dexterity and with incredible design. Look at this beautiful piece. This is the Unicorn in Captivity. It's a southern Netherlandish piece. I think it's part of a series, if I remember correctly, done in the Renaissance period, 1475-1500. What a beautiful piece. It's a wonderful little composition here, the circular composition, the tree coming out, and of course the unicorn right in the center. We get this lovely pattern of greenery and lush foliage here in the background, all done in this technique called tapestry. So those are the techniques and crafts that you need to be aware of, and make sure you go over those and take a look at those. And we're going to take a break. We're going to come back. We have a guest, so don't go away, okay? We'll see you in just a few minutes.
College and Program Service of California State University, Bemidji Sales.
Welcome to California State University of Dominguez Hills. We are really, really proud to have this partnership with the Picture Arts Foundation. This event is extremely important. I am proud of this collaboration that's been developed between the University Library, the Art Department, and the Picture Arts Foundation.
First of all, I'd like to welcome and thank everyone for being here today to share with us this very exciting and important day of our Picture Foundation. We share the same planet, we share many common beliefs in our lives. Let us celebrate our similarities and respect our differences.
Skills represents such a wonderful establishment of cultures. Our culture, both cultures, and our signature of our community.
State University Dominguez Hills Department of Theater and Dance have made it easier than ever to attend a performance on campus. You can now go online, buy a ticket, and choose your seat all with the click of your mouse. Just go to tickets.csudh.edu, click on Buy Your Ticket, choose your seat, and you'll be on your way to the theater.
Hi, my name is Mark Jordan, and I'm currently a student at Cal State Dominguez. I transferred from Santa Monica College, and I love the environment here at Cal State Dominguez. I'm majoring in communications right now, and I love the program. The teachers are great, and the environment is awesome. So I enjoy being here.
Go!
You're watching BHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University of Minnesota.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art, right here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. Oh, I get my tongue all together here. And we are into our second half of the class today, and I just dropped part of my architecture. Well, so much for the arch. Let's see where if we can find this. I'll get Ruben talking here, and then I'll look for that in a little bit. Oh, Ruben found it. Oh, thank God for the Renaissance architecture, the Gothic architecture. Okay, we have a guest, Ruben Jacobs. He's already introduced himself by picking up my architecture. Thank you, Ruben, for being here.
Thank you.
Now, do we have a nameplate? I thought we had a name thing for him to announce. You're in the architecture area from the as a designer, right?
Yes, with an architectural background. I went to USC School of Architecture and got a bachelor's degree in architecture. And since that time, I have worked in the architectural field, either working for corporate large firms, or I'm starting to do a lot of consulting work for myself in the last half decade.
Yes. So I know you're kind of in business for yourself a little bit, right? You're involved in?
I'm still involved in architecture. Okay. I'm doing a lot of consulting for architects and interior designers, which I'm actually doing a lot of their drawing for drawings that get approved by the building department, as well as the design drawings that get illustrated, and we work out the design that the client wants to see and work to that regard. So it's the same thing I was doing for corporate.
I see.
For myself. And I also do some of my own projects, which are small design projects for residential customers.
You can spread out.
I'm spread out.
Okay.
And also I teach.
That's right. You told me you teach. I teach
computer-aided drafting at the Southern California Regional Occupation Center, in SoCal Rock, down in the South Bay.
Okay.
And I've taught at numerous junior colleges computer-aided drafting classes for architecture and interior design students. Right now, I'm teaching at Mount SAC, which is out in Walnut, the beginning interior design class and how to draft and draw.
So, like so many of the professions in our area, graphic design, industrial design, all these, the computer has just...
It took over.
It's over.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Nearly 20 years now.
That doesn't exclude still the ability to be creative.
That's correct. Or to think.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yes.
You can't rely on that computer to do the thinking or the creating.
Not at all. And a friend of mine teased, there's no button on there. We could just say create hospital or house.
But today I'm just talking to one of my students about a project we were working on, and she's an interior designer, and she wants to be an interior designer. She's involved in that. She loves that. And she asked me, she said, can I draw stick figures for this project?
anesthetized it. And I said, what do you measure? She said, interior design. And I said, well, what do you do when you have to visualize your interior design? She said, I do it on the computer. I said, why don't you draw? So we got into this whole discussion about the need for the ability to draw.
Yeah, and it's still going on in the schools I teach in. They still teach perspective drawing, even different drawing medium. I tell people that CAD is just another drawing medium. It's not the only one. So you still need some freehand capabilities, how to use markers and different things that you can illustrate. Because in this day and age, the bottom line, the finished product is a three-dimensional CAD rendering, but the stuff along the way, the process, is still being done through the mind, to paper. And rendering on a computer takes a long time. So you want to be able to convey some of these initial thoughts and stuff on paper.
You wonder how many of those projects have been clinched over on a table over lunch.
You see that all the time.
Yeah. You can't do that. I got the idea right here.
Right here.
Go.
There we go. Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. I like that idea. Let me remind you folks, if you want to ask Ruben a question or you want to comment on something, call. What's the number? 800-339-1193. That number is blazing in number. Or you can text. A lot of you are texting, and I appreciate that because I can read it right here on the screen. Ruben can read it, and we can respond to you. And a lot of you might be interested in architecture or some allied area of architecture. I'm sure there's lots of those.
Lots of
them. Yes. Interior is one.
Yes.
Exactly. So, if you have comments or questions for Ruben, please, this is your opportunity to have some direct communication with him. Okay. I have a question for you. I'll just put this out here for you. And I know you and I have talked about this already. This is the answer of the day. Okay? The answer of the day. The answer is organic architecture. What is the question? Let's see if anybody comes up with a good question. With the answer of organic architecture. Okay, we'll let that lay out there and see what happens. I have another question I'll bring up later on. Okay, we'll talk about that later on. I see I have them together here. I'll put that mess up my people in there who are doing the graphics. There are a number of structural systems that our author talks about. And I'm sure you can comment on probably any or all of these. There's a little too long. But he talks about load-bearing construction. And you kind of see that as almost like piling up a bunch of bricks or something, just piling on it. And horizontal. And the round arch and the vault. Have you worked with any of these? I'm sure you have. Maybe not.
The load bearing, the horizontal, not being done is much now, not nearly.
I'm just seeing that little big old 4x4 across the window.
I'm thinking that they're more of the keystone in the right, but yes, general construction is still rooted from what they've been doing in the past. They're just using different materials now and kind of in different ways. But the domes and arches not done as often as and as much as they used to, virtually not at all.
Well, that's interesting because you and I were talking about Frank Gehry's work in like the Walt Disney Comfort Hall. And I mean, all these organic shapes. In fact, I think we have a picture of that someplace. You guys haven't seen that picture while we're talking. Oh, that's not good. Anyway, if you guys see that picture, pop it up.
We go to Disney Comfort Hall.
It's an icon here in LA, no doubt about it. But anyway. I haven't been in that building, but kind of, I've only been in the entryway of it. But the point is that I was in the building up in the Gehry building up in
Seattle.
You know, I talked about that.
Exactly.
And the interior of that is almost dome-like in the sense that he's got these spaces that are soaring up and then girdled and That's not it. That's the both the Disney building in Orlando. I forgot who that's by.
I think I meant to get it, but I could do it.
I don't got that something. And all of that reminded me of domes. Simply by the fact that he's got all these curved shapes, and on the inside,
right,
you see it kind of like a concave shape.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you mentioned about new techniques or new materials, it made me think of new innovations on an old theme.
Correct.
Like an arch or a dome or a person.
New technologies. Exactly. He does a lot of his design and shapes through computer-aided crafting.
Yeah.
And he actually uses software that is more used by the aerospace industry that develops things more three-dimensional. And architects think three-dimensionally but develop plans and the like and move it through there, where he has actually used this program that is more used to design airplanes and things. It's kind of more egg-shaped. And you can develop a form that has for slice cuts of that from the form. So he's kind of developing from a different way.
Yeah.
And being able to use that to, you're now starting to use that to create what we call construction, not only construction drawings, but fabrication drawings.
I see.
And so it becomes much easier to develop the buildings he's developed for there. There's a Disney concept.
This is where it is, yeah. What a fabulous place. And it's so sculptural. And of course, so organic. I mean, it's just amazing. It's an amazing building. What a comment from that. He says, my fellow nurse, Mac, complains that he's left architecture because computers took over and killed the creativity and job market for architects. Is this just sour grapes on him? What do you think?
One could argue that, but I really don't think he's taken over. Just because you still, as we just said, you have to think. You have to think it through. You still have to conceive. You're the one that has to come up with this. Some of the architecture you do see is kind of a byproduct of just putting out there what is generated from the computer plan. But I think that was the same problem you can have by doing hand drawing if you weren't actually creative.
That's right.
I don't think that was necessarily the case.
Okay.
I think the computers actually allowed us to explore a lot more quickly.
Well, for example of Frank Gehry using aerospace technology,
right,
for his creativity. I mean, that's a good example.
And you can see some things that would take you a long time to draw.
Well, he might not be able to get to this without that.
It would be a construction nightmare because they couldn't perceive it.
Exactly. Okay, well, this says architecture that combines human and nature in a hybrid system where neither transgresses the other is organic architecture. It's not exactly what I'm after, but let's let that hang out there and see. You're kind of in the ballpark, but I'm after something more specific that Mark related. From our textbook talks about organic architecture. So you can come up with something more specific, but you're on the right road.
On the right track.
Yeah, I think she's on the right road. What's Philip going to say? We have more coming up. He's really reaching. He's reaching here. Let's see what he says. See if anybody agrees with Philip. He says, what is Frank Lloyd Wright's theory of domestic architecture that blends with the environment and integrates the interior and the exterior of a house? Would that be organic architecture? Let's see if anybody agrees with Philip on this. He might be onto something. Let's see if anybody else can reiterate that or agree with Philip. Or maybe disagree with Philip. Maybe organic architecture is something that gardeners do when they're building compost piles. That might be it. See what Monique has to say. She says, what technique can you use when you use aerospace technology? That is a good question for you.
What technique can you use when you use aerospace technology? Well, that, you mean what I just referred to in that software?
Yeah.
Well, it's the aerospace industry, I mean, a lot of their things, the main thing, airplanes,
are kind of an organic shape. If you look at the plane, and even you look at the engine hull, it's kind of egg-shaped.
That's right.
Where buildings are boxy. So by nature, on the ground, it's got to be at least somewhat squared off. And thus, you can imagine that the floor plan for a building is literally cutting through that building. So if we use one of your blocks, for example, we cut through, it's still that shape as a uniform all the way through. If I use this cup as an example, a more organic shape, if I cut it down here versus if I cut it up here, it starts to change, and it's,
we can see
and we can see that
yeah.
shape. So aerospace wings are more dynamic, such as cars and automobiles, and they're not as homogenous and uniform in shape. So to be able to use a software that enables you to kind of capture that more cleanly.
So do you think that innovation on the part of Gary will transcend into traditional architectural software?
No.
It
won't, although the most practically used, the commonly used software right now is making it more easy to develop three-dimensional drawings. So you see what you're developing, and it's helping us as architects and people in the field actually keep track of and coordinate our work three-dimensionally. We're not thinking we're coordinated while we were constructing it.
Yes.
For example, we work with engineers, we work with architects, work with electrical, mechanical, plumbing engineers, and just duct work and piping that has to go into the building. All of that has to coincide together and miss each other. Structural engineering, and a lot of that coordination was something we had to catch by eye looking at two-dimensional drawings.
Yes.
Now the latest software is enabling us to put it in three-dimensionally and actually do something called clash detection and discern before we even get out there if a pipe is in conflict with a beam or is in conflict with a duct. And we can actually see that three-dimensionally. And that is the next step that is being used right now, more so than kind of the more aerospace software.
It does seem a lot embarrassing on the part of the.
Oh, yes. It costs a lot of
interest. That's a big
thing. It happens. All the time.
Okay, so the left says architecture that combines human and elves. We already did the left. Okay, so that's the only comments we've had so far on those. I just want to show, just to let students know, because this is important for your quizzes and things coming up, and I brought in the architectural thing you don't use.
Mm-hmm.
You're good at this. Where I put my posting
needles.
Imagine my posting needles. There's the post. Everybody can see this. Can you see this post? Good, so you can see it. There's the post. And you have the honor to know me. There is the lintel. So that's pretty straightforward. Everyone see that?
AKA posting beam.
Posting beam, that's right, that's another term for it. And from that, of course, came the other one from the Romans, but I think it was developed before the Romans. I don't know if I have the number, I don't think I have to have these numbers. They give the Romans credit for this Roman arch, but there's examples of this that go back to Mesopotamia and some periods of that time. I didn't know that until I was. Involved in this course. There's two. This has a number. Yeah, number six goes here. That's how the number really won't fit.
So, look over here, maybe.
And this is Keystone. That's five.
Three, really.
You get this number right beside here. This is these two architects, but they're a good thing to do.
A whole lot more people to build a building.
Yeah. And both, believe it or not, is the keystone. So there you go. Voila, the round arch. Everyone see that round arch? Come back where you see it. See that round arch? There you go. The Roman arch, very classic piece of architecture, particularly here in Southern California. You see these all over the place.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's, we do it as a design aesthetic where we haven't really built it in that construction system, but we harken back to the periods of design themes from those times.
And lastly, I'm sure at least we're going to have Ruben show us a bunch of his stuff. This is the, and it looks like you this out of the way. This is the classic, well, I can't say classic, that implies make a moment. But this is the time rush. 2, 3, keystone, 5, and 6. So this is the classic pointed arch. And so that came wrong, but then they were saying, can you guys see that? There you go, see that pointed arch? But because it was so tough, and there was a lot of stained glass windows in the cathedrals, they came up and said, let's put in something to hold this wall up a little tighter. And they put in a buttress. Very good.
As we call the flying buttress.
Flying buttress. There it is. It's the best flying buttress, the pointed arch with the flying buttress. And you need to know this, because this may come up and guide you, you know, where. Okay. We have a good picture of some amazing buttress. This, I believe, is, this may be Sharks Cathedral, I can't remember, I'm kind of. No, this is the exterior of Cathedral Romanus. And you can see the flying buttresses right here. See those arches coming down? And also, well, I guess this whole unit here is flying buttresses.
Yes.
Am I right about that?
Yes.
And here's the stained glass, one of the characteristics, all that open stained glass is one of the characteristics of the Gothic period, the Gothic cathedrals. So you've got the flying buttress, the pointed arch, and the stained glass are three of the primary characteristics of the Gothic cathedrals.
That goes back to the stained glass you spoke of
in
such a way.
The beautiful stained glass, it is too. That's in that stained glass, like in, we'll see a piece here in a minute. I was thinking of Notre Dame. And I had an opportunity to see that years ago when I was much younger. Beautiful.
And that piece of cabinetry you showed in session 1 and 2 is kind of very indicative of what you see in Notre Dame.
That's right. That's right. Mooney says, using material native to the immediate surroundings so that the house blends into an environment. Okay, I'll buy that one.
Yes.
I'll buy that. Lynette says, oh, she's asking you a question. Go ahead. You can
How many disciplines do architects consult with during their work? I would think in California, one would want to know geology, analyze earthquake risk, flooding. Architects in general deal with a vast number of, we say, consultants and experts in different fields. Mm-hmm. Architects are really the ringleader of the built environment, if you will.
We're
the hub, but we actually have to consult with let's name a few key ones. The engineer, structural engineer, which help us make the building stand, and that aesthetic. Mechanical engineering for your AC and heating and the like. Plumbing engineer for your water systems and stuff that's coming through. Electrical engineering. And then it comes, depending on the building type, you can have a variety of different consultants, such as acoustical engineers become very important in Disney concert halls and movie theaters and stuff. Not so important in any mechanics workshop. So it just really depends on the project and the type of thing that are being built and used.
Yeah.
So that is just a very short list of consultants. Even electrical engineering, you have low voltage engineering. I mean, low voltage electrical systems and all that you have to deal with. So you actually deal with a large number of folks.
So it all begins in the beginning of the planning stages of a piece of a project.
Yes.
Like identifying the use of the building and the way the building's going to be servicing the community or whatever it is that determines who you're going to be consulting with. There are some common things, of course, but there's a lot of extraordinary kinds of consulting you have to deal with.
Exactly.
So,
people that make deal with transportation.
For traffic?
If you travel, obviously you have fun dealing with the airport security issues.
Yes.
Large volumes of people. If I'm doing large residents, still a completely different thing than doing a Staples Center.
Of course.
With that. And that's sort of like. So as architects, we kind of come up with this built artistic environment.
Yes.
And we deal with our clients and kind of come in and figure out what we call a program, what a client needs and wants, and kind of create a laundry list of what is needed and convert that into a building, a structure.
Okay, that's a good analogy. Okay. Bruce says, organic architecture, a philosophy of architecture which promotes harmony between human habitation and the natural world. Well, that's one way of looking at it. I agree with that. That's kind of what, to some extent, what Frank Lloyd Wright did. Do you think?
In a lot of cases, yes, he did. Yes.
So I think you definitely have an answer to that question about organic architecture. Essentially, it's Frank Lloyd Wright's philosophy of architecture that he used in so much of his work, particularly his residential.
Yes.
Where he would bring in the material from the
different house of falling water.
It's
a prime example of that.
Yeah.
Even in this house, which is very interesting, it's perched right on a hillside, and the living room space had this natural rock that he preserved, he left. So the fireplace and the floor finish is actually the stone that was there to start.
So it's the natural stone?
It's the natural stone. And that's a literal use of it, to actually use it. A lot of times, as someone said, with your organic architecture, maybe just taking advantage of the fact that it's in an area that's woody,
right,
and they can bring in a lot of those same woods and, you know, use them in the design.
Yes.
Or you're in an area with a lot of stone quarries where that's right there, and you can roughly actually use that and incorporate that into the design.
This is what he did in this film.
And another piece of thought on organic architecture is if your structure can actually blend into society and almost evaporate.
Yes, of course.
So
aesthetic
treatment too is, I mean, and all of these are examples of leaving one out or doing only one doesn't preclude you from being.
And also another part of that you and I talked about last week is involvement of creating not just the building, but if not all, much of the furnishings.
Right.
And the other, even dinerware, I mean, even this subtle detail.
Yes. Our whole philosophy, what architects are trying to do is we're charged with developing this built environment, so we're trying to think it all the way through to how a client is actually going to use the building.
Yes.
Because, you know, it's not just to create a shelter, but to actually create a space that is comfortable for its users and fits what they're going to do.
Yes.
And it also looks into the future, too.
That's good.
Okay. I mean, we can look at technology right now, and you look at a library, and how a library was done 30 years ago can't be how you would design it now.
Yes.
With the internet, I know most of the students and kids don't know car catalog, that's a thing of the past, right? So how do you develop a library or design a library that is reaching into how we're evolving as a society or using it? How can you interpret that into?
Well, we can appreciate the fallacy of architects in the past not having the ability, probably because people didn't see what was going to happen, the changes that would take place in just libraries as an example. I mean, I think of the money that's being spent, at least probably not so much now, there's not that much money in the government anymore, but in the past, in renovating libraries.
That's the other thing, adaptive use.
Yeah.
Architecture, I think people automatically think that we start with dirt when we have a built environment that's there and we have to modernize a building.
Yes.
Or transform a building that had a previous use into a new use. You can have a library that's no longer used, and a new developer comes along and says, this is a great two-story space, I want to make a mix of it.
Yes.
Well, how do we convert that? What is that use going to be? And how do we transform it into that? All of that is art.
And that's a major project in itself, isn't it?
Yes. And that's fun. to re-adapt your use, right? How do you do this? So all of that is in it.
I just wanted to follow up on, let me just get to Philip first. He said, this is for Ruben. Ruben, go ahead and take that.
When do you think the competition for the tallest building will end, or has it already reached the limit? I don't think it'll ever end, mainly just because technology changes and our capabilities change. It's a really good question because how buildings were built, what were skyscrapers in the past, were as tall as they were, or now we look back and say as short as they are, because of the limitations of the materials that we had at the time. And now that things have changed, we're able to do things differently. We're able to do taller things. I'll give one example that's a really good one. The World Trade Center, the former one that's gone, was a unique building and they were able to make it as tall as they did because they got rid of the problem or got around the problem of your elevator shafts. Typically, you're that tall. When you're that tall, you're going to have more and more elevator shafts to get people up there. Well, they thought of having basically transfer elevators, where you went up X amount of floors and had to transfer to another set of elevators. And the other big problem was, the taller you get, the more structure you have. Structure has to come down to the ground. So by the time you get so high, well, getting high is not a problem. It's the lower floors that have so much structure on them. So the upper floors, is it worth it to continue going up? Because there's so little usable floor space there. And what that building did was take the core of the building, the elevator shaft, and make that this central-like column. And it made the perimeter of the building the exterior structure, and thus it took out all the need for all these columns throughout the floor plate and made it an open floor.
The unique way of
concentrating the structure.
Yeah.
And making the floor usable, because before that, we're like, well, it's no sense in going that high if most of the floor below have so much structure. So again, how is structure being able to become lighter and stronger? You don't know where they'll go.
So the question, the answer to this question,
it's possible. That's why architects and engineers are looking at those new ways to develop things.
Yes. Okay, good question, Philip. Okay, I just want to follow up on the Kaufman House because it's important, because some questions are going to come up about the Kaufman House. Some characteristics I just wanted to point out to you, because you will need to know these. One is that it's designed for a wooded site with a waterfall. Second, it's built with roughly poured stone. Third, it uses cantilever. That's that big piece that came over. Yeah, here it is. Let me just show these are the cantilever areas. I think there's another one over here. They're just big areas that extend out from the main support parts. And lastly, interior is integrated with the exterior. And so you need one of those four characteristics. And as mentioned, the characteristics of Wright's domestic architecture, also called organic architecture, is architecture should blend with the environment. That's one of his axioms. Second is the interior and exterior is visibly and physically integrated. So those are two of the main theses of his organic architecture. Okay, enough about Frank Lloyd Wright. Let's talk about your architecture.
Yes.
A lot of pieces of show some of the things.
I get those sort of things.
Go ahead and use what you'd like to show us.
Well, some of the more recent work I've done, this was a residential project. If we look at slide number one, this was a house that is already existing, and the client just simply wanted to add to the front portion of the house a study. An additional bedroom and bath on the second floor and relocate a laundry room. So I'm showing you a slide of how it was before I even got there.
Okay.
And if you go to slide two, you can start to see, if you move to slide two, you can see the new construction in development. and you can start to see Sean Posty beam down there. This is actually holding it up there.
That's a major addition here. You got this whole...
It's actually a smaller addition than you would think. That's probably 20 feet out front, like 20 feet square, if you will. So a total of about 800 square feet compared to a house that was already 3,500 square feet.
So it's a big house.
So it's a big house to start with.
Yes.
But the transformation was to make a two-story entry piece, as you could see that high parking volume there.
Is there in here?
Yes, the client wanted something that was more two-story in appearance. If you go back to slide one for a quick second, you can see how it was a little porch area right there. We go to slide three, we can see how it pretty much came out.
So this is
now the entry, and the front porch was just moved out front, still gave them the same porch that they had. We move quickly to slide six. It's a good example of some of the drawings that we developed, which is that front elevation, the front view of what you're seeing, and this is what we would show a client, obviously, before it's built, and give them an idea. If you go to seven, you start to see some different finishes and materials that I was proposing to put on it.
So you mentioned earlier, this is the second option, so you're showing the client several different ways of how this can be completed
and look, right? Because you can't do the built thing.
Right.
And it's too much to do. So we try and create drawings that can give them a rendition, an idea of what things look like. And that's why the CAD environment is so powerful now, because we can do these three-dimensional renderings that look like a photograph of what will be. CAD stands for computer-aided drafting.
Okay.
Yes.
And basically, it allows you to make these kind of drawings.
Yes. And that's what that is right there. It is just supplanted hand drafting.
Okay.
Is what it's done. It's just a different way of doing it. Now, three-dimensional CAD is becoming a much more powerful thing.
I see.
And this is two-dimensional. So we've got width and heights of things, but you can see it's not three-dimensional. Mm-hmm. As if we went back to slide four, let's say. If we went to slide four, you can see the actual three-dimensional as the actual project. But we can now do drawings that are three-dimensional models
on
a computer that can show just this.
I see.
And we can actually put it geographically where it is, meaning show that it's in Spain and it's this time of year, and show how light qualities hit it and the like. We can do all of that.
That's not more appealing to a client who's kind of naive in terms of understanding.
Exactly. We can apply materials to it, actual materials, stone or light. So it's a unbelievable thing.
So you're really approximating a photograph almost of what the piece is going to look like.
Nowadays, not almost. I've seen some, I didn't think to bring one of those in, a rendering that looked like a photograph.
Oh, that's incredible. Well, yeah, I really appreciate that.
Because they can deal with reflection.
Yes.
In glass, and basically how you render materials to look like real materials.
One of the factors that you mentioned is so important, and we kind of overlook this. I'm doing stuff outside. And that is the effect of the sun and light and the time of year.
Yes.
That, the situation and all that.
Yeah, and that's what architects deal with. That's getting into the nuts and bolts of it. But we're taught early on how the sun affects a project.
Yes.
Because where we put our position, our windows, is going to affect the use.
Yes.
And when you pay attention to that, if you want to put your big screen on a TV on a wall that faces a western window, and the sun is coming in the afternoon when you want to use it, and all this glare is going on, so it's like, who is the architect? We're talking these things. A lot of southern exposure, that's when the sun is the brightest, the hottest, and all of that. We're sensitive to these things as we design a project. So as I talked earlier in the program, we take that laundry list of things you want and need, and we deal with it contextually. Contextually, a big word for saying, where is it? In site-wise, geographically, is it in Wisconsin, a place that's cold sometimes, or is it in Southern California that's hot a lot of the time? Contextually, do you have a great view of the ocean, so do you want to embrace that view, or are you on a busy street and you want to back that harsh
yes.
reality? So we design, take that program and convert that into a building that works best contextually.
So that's one of the advantages of having an architect as opposed to buying like the houses that are in the neighborhood of these developments where they just put down the same it goes around all the spaces every direction, and you get into one house and
an architect is like a designer, clothes designer, we're tailoring that to you.
That's right.
Your shape is not the same as everybody else's, nor your taste, what you want this building to be used for, how long do you want to use it.
Yes.
Your budget, always a big one, but there's numerous different factors that will go into how we design this thing.
It's another reason for you folks to go to college, so you can earn enough money to afford an architect. So there you go.
We like to work with everyone. So actually, one of the biggest, problems for our field is that it has traditionally been, and I mean traditionally for centuries, been an elitist profession. So it was always thought that, the common man could never afford an architect's work. When the reality is you really should avoid leaving them out of the mix.
That's right.
Because we could be a help if it's nothing more than bringing us in to get ideas.
Yes.
I'm thinking about remodeling this room or buying this house. I want to add on to it. Well, I could start to listen to how you want to use this home. Is your family expanding? Are you retiring? What are you using it for? What do you want to do? And give you some ideas in just one conversation that maybe a realtor can't give you. We are just like legal professionals, legal counsel. You may not retain them to take you in a court of law, so you may not retain us to draw drawings, but you would probably talk with an accounting lawyer before you start filing or sending something to the IRS, right? Because they know that type of law, so we know this type of thing.
Let me invite you again to text in or call in if you want to make a comment to Ruben, asking about architecture, asking about any aspects of what we're talking about, and let him lend you some good advice and some good comments on what your interest might be.
Image 12. It would be the interior space of this house.
Okay, we're going to look at you did the interior as well as the exterior. So you did the whole.
Oh, you have to. In this case, for example, the stairway you see was already there. It's that upper area where the balcony jets out.
All up in here?
Actually, just to the right.
Over this?
Just that. Okay. That was what I had to add. So I actually went and found a railing that matched the existing railing. And the archway that you see on the left side of that, up.
Oh, the archway up there.
That one is what I created. That one that you just drew was there already.
Okay, so this was here.
I did that one to get you to the addition that's beyond there.
Okay.
So it starts to show you how we do have to work with the, we're not working with an empty palette all the time. And so some of the best architecture is to look like nothing happened. sometimes it's good. You want to make a statement that this piece of architecture is here. We don't want students to think that everything actually has to be organic.
Yes.
Sometimes we want to make a statement that this is something out of this world.
Unique to this
environment.
Okay.
And so, but we want to be conscious about which one we're doing and why we're doing it.
Of course.
And so that's what's going on with that one. I have some other examples here. If we go to slide 18, this is a good example of actually a physical model. Slide 18 is a model of a hospital I worked on, a UCLA hospital, which is a very large project. To give you an idea, this is over 1 million square feet. And to give people an idea of what that is, you can imagine a pretty good sized house is 3,000 square feet. Well, 33 of those, right, is
getting to
1/10.
So you folks designed this entire
to the entire hospital from the ground up in the South UCLA campus.
That was like some unique consultation, wouldn't it?
It was just a large team. There was a team of 40 to 50 architects. There were dozens of engineers from the various different types of engineers. And then there are people that specialize in the different things, which we touched on and we talked about last week. But we want people to understand with architecture that there isn't just this one thing of designing a building and drawing. There are many things, from the renderings that you see, which can create pictures and the like. This is a physical model. So this is a model that's only the size of this table, and then you have the size of this table. There are people that know how to build those. There are people that know how to work on a construction job site and work with the contractor as they're building it and answer questions that he has as the project is being developed. I actually got a chance to do that on this project, too. I worked on the site for 2 years after working on the drawings for a long time. So there are many aspects of the field. And the things that you can think of as far as architecture is you've got the different building types, and then you've got the different aspects and functions of being an architect within it.
We have a comment from Steve. What does he have to say for you?
What are architects doing to make the built environment more green and less carbon dependent? A lot right now. That's a major buzz term, a major focus of attention for everyone, including architects right now. So there's a whole specialty in green architecture that has evolved in the last 10, 15 years. And there's actually ways to certify. People can get certified in this green architecture, and buildings now can actually get this stamp of approval for accreditation of how green the buildings are.
So this is a new specialization.
It's a whole other new specialization that is still part of architecture. And it's funny that architects have been thinking about this from Frank Lloyd Wright before, but a lot of it has actually just been swept under the rug because clients, it wasn't a focus of their attention. And some of these things cost more. So if we came up with the idea of doing that, and they say, well, you know, it just costs too much to do, don't want to do it. Then we are also have to deal with the products that we work with. For example, carpets. Carpets were much more toxic in the past. Now carpet manufacturers are paying attention with what they're using to glue down carpets and the like and making it more organic. So it's making it easier for architects and clients to use these things. So we are, in answer to that question, yes, that is a very big thing right now. And it's kind of catching on in society. So architects are responding.
So this is a response also that industry is making items more affordable for the mass public and for thinking of solar panels, for example.
And that's where people's mind automatically go when they think of architecture and things. But there are things that architects have been doing for years. Passive solar systems are what we call natural solar system. So you can use solar panels and heat up water and do things like that. But you can do things passively. If I design the building so that I have windows on opposite ends, when you open those windows, I automatically get a breeze to come through.
Yes.
Just from the positioning of the windows. And that's what we call passive systems, as opposed to actual mechanical systems that can do some of these things. And like I said, products now, more and more products aren't made the bad way anymore. So sometimes it's less expensive. A lot of times it isn't less expensive. It's more expensive, but the choice has been taken away because society is realizing that it's more important to be green and less toxic to us and at whatever cost that is. And another thing to point out on this whole green architecture is that buildings are the biggest energy hog there is out there. So when you compare that to a car with its little toxic fumes that are happening, imagine your smallest building is your house, let alone the office building is taking up a city block. So the amount of energy and waste that it can produce over a 30 to 100 year period is much more important. And that's why we're starting to spend a lot more time paying attention to that.
Good point.
Yeah, we go with the first slide. good team. We'll go through some of these kind of quickly. Go through 19, we see that same hospital project. Go to 20, you look at the main entryway. Mm-hmm. And 21 starts to bring you into that entryway. So you start, this was developed. That glass system that you see beyond is what we refer to as a curtain wall system.
That's this area?
That area. That's referred to as a wall of glass. And so it's not structural. It's actually being supported by the structural system behind.
I see.
Everyone's seen a building before it's clad, and you see those steel I-beams and columns. That's essentially what's holding that up. And this glass system is attached, anchoring to that system. The glass, and it's some of the glass is spandrel glass, which is glass you can't see through. And a lot of times that's in an area where a ceiling is, where ductwork is, and you don't want to see through it. The clear glass is where we stand in the space and we can look through the building. But from the outside, you can't tell spandrel from clear.
Oh, I see.
Because we just color that as a painted glass, but it gives the building this overall appearance of all glass. When you see this all.
Now, what were the aesthetic concerns for a structure like this on a hospital? I mean, they think, when do we want this to be expressed?
Some of the concepts on this is the UCLA campus. And if you go to the UCLA campus, you see that there's a style and tradition of architecture that's there that most buildings follow. And the medical campus, which is just a portion of the campus, is kind of taking on a life of its own. It's different from that brick. Look, it's very traditional. Looks a lot like USC too.
Yeah.
And so the medical campus is more concrete, steel, and glass, and it allowed them to come up with a more modern, non-traditional looking building. This building is mostly the tan color you see is actually stone. And the stones are like the size of this table. So the scale there, you don't read that. And that's another thing we pay attention to is scale of things. Meaning how big things are in relation to other things.
Yes.
You know, when you do a one-story building, a stone that may be the size of you, 5 feet in size, is going to look different than if you put it on a high-rise building.
Makes sense.
So we pay attention to proportion and materials and the like while we're designing this.
So you're really getting right back to the fundamentals of art.
Yes, it is. Well, architecture is art.
It is indeed.
It's the art of built environment.
Yes,
and we like to refer to it. So the difference in it is, you know, you have to create something that's usable. A lot of times art is an appreciable piece of art that we can look at and appreciate, but most times buildings cannot be something where you say, oh, that's nice, okay. We've got to use it.
Yes,
and we've got to use it over many years, many decades, in other countries, many centuries. So we have to blend those two. We're blending technology, we're blending art, and we're blending usage, how we're using it, with the environment.
Okay.
So that's what makes it all pretty exciting.
Yes, it does.
So we just will show a couple of materials in this. We'll go to 22, and then go to just do 22, and then flash to 23 right after that. You can start to see the interiors of that space. 23, if we go to 24, those are shots of the main lobby, the ground floor area, which was done, you know, as you can see, this hospital is done very ornately, very nice, so it's, you don't always get a chance to do something like that.
Yeah,
we'll do that. Project like that. And then I included some other photos of some other people's work. If we go to slide 14. Slide 14 is actually Compton College's library.
Oh, really?
As a matter of fact, I think this was done within 10 years. So this is done by another architectural firm, Raw Architecture, close friends of mine. And I wanted to show other people's work because as you study architecture and as you do architecture, you certainly do not want to stay within the bubble of what you do.
Yes.
Because it is art. And you're looking at how society is evolving, what other artists and architects are doing, and you let that influence your work. And so it's very good to not only look at other individuals' work, but start to understand what they've done. You may not like it. You may not like that style, But if you can learn from it and start to appreciate it, you can start to use those things through your architecture, even if it's just the same. I would never do that. I don't agree with that. I think you can understand some of that. It becomes a pretty powerful thing.
This is the same thing for another profession as well. I'm going to say graphic design, industrial design, package design, or music. All of it has the same kind of crossover.
And we should use that. If you don't take advantage of that, then you actually become stagnant and very predictable.
Exactly.
If we go to slide 15 and 16, I wanted to show these. Go to 15, and you start to see some of the interiors. You know, interior design, something referred to interior architecture, is the interiors of the space. And I always try and crash these walls down because there are interior designers and there are architects. They specialize in the two things. The architects really specialize in the whole overall building,
Coming
together of everything. Interior designers, as you can see, start to deal with the specifics of the finishes and the detail of how things come together, glass to wall. You can see this is a very atypical looking wall. They did this wall in a chamfered angle. This is David right here.
Yes.
And this is a dentist's office. Actually, it's a dentist of the stars. He does some of these big home improvement shows. The dentist there, I forget his name. But it's, again, it's raw, one of Raw's former clients. But I wanted to show that and crash those walls down because I think of interior design as part of architecture. It's not one or the other. And sometimes, as architects, you're not actually dealing directly or doing, say, the interior design, but you need to have a concept of how things are going to be carried out and start to set that pattern up because that's what's affecting your overall building.
Now, does that mean that there's an interior design firm that will act as on a consultant basis with the architect?
Sometimes they deal directly with the client. That's a good question. We have buildings that we call, shell buildings, and you can see how office buildings are built, and it's just the shell and core, which is the elevators and mechanical systems that make it work, and the envelope of the building, and you have raw, empty space there. Now a tenant comes in, whoever that tenant may be, some corporate guy, a law firm, whoever comes in and says, I want to lease this space out, X amount of thousand square feet, they come in with their own architect and interior design firm, and they build that space out. But that is done independent to the architect that did the first shell of the building.
Yeah.
Or it's already been built, and now a new tenant comes in, and they want to change what's there to their use. So these things all go. Sometimes they go hand in hand, and sometimes they follow each other, and we're all working with.
Folks, we're down to 1 minute here. I want to mention that we are going to be going into the second half of the semester. Don't forget the ArtSight paper, and Roland, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
All this information.
I hope I helped you, folks.
More of you. Caroline, we'll see you next week. Keep looking at art, everybody.